Sammy, what are you doing? This is unbelievable!
The headshot, what? After headshot, after headshot!
How did you turn the card around and round?
Thank you, oh!
He's killed four players now on his own!
Trying to sustain everyone grouping under Ivy. He does fall to the tanks, but it costs them all their HP.
99 to 99!
Today on Kickoff, I'll talk with Mr. Niksich about the future of esports and Elijah A's check in on students to see what their favorite game was growing up. Welcome to Kickoff. On October 19, 1972, history would be made as the first esports competition was held at Stanford University. Now, 50 years later, Maryville will host its first esports club with over 100 students signing up. The esports club was a success, but the big question is, will it come back for another season of gaming? And with that said, let's head over to the interview. What were the pros and cons in making an esports club?
Well, last year, Mr. Stamper approached me about possibly starting an esports club here at Maryville High School. Coming out of the pandemic and the challenges that the students and faculty went through, I thought it was a great idea, and I was definitely excited to, you know, to be part of the promotion of the esports program. Our first call-out meeting, I was overwhelmed. We had, I think you were there, we had well over 100 kids in the building. So as far as, you know, there was plenty of pros. I didn't really feel like there were many cons last year. There was plenty of students that were willing and able. I was able also to find a handful of teachers that were willing and able to volunteer their time. So I had to find some teachers that were willing to participate, and that was successful as well.
So it just sounded like a whole very like successful journey. But telling that to Mr. Crud, did you feel any type of pressure, like telling him like, hey, I want to make a club that I think will be great, and without knowing that over 100 students, you know, will sign up? Because that, for a club, that is some numbers. I ain't feel like.
I've worked with Mr. Crutz for many years, and he's been a great boss, and he's a great leader, and he always wants to do what's best for students. So when I approached him, he was all in. He knew that there was a, I'm not going to say he knew there was a need for it, but he recognized that we needed something to make this place a little more accommodating for all levels of learners. And there are many gamers in the building, and we wanted to make this a place that is accommodating, a place where people feel comfortable in their surroundings. So yeah, Mr. Crutz was all in, and it is something that we'd like to make happen in the near future.
So the big question, Mr. Niksich, do you think we'll see another year in esports?
I don't want to give too much information, but we are in the process of running it back in a little more controlled environment, working with Mr. Mahar, who is currently the chess sponsor. We are working with him to try to expand it to incorporate some of the esports. So he's currently meeting on Mondays and Thursdays up in his room. I do have two computer labs that have been installed with gaming computers. So we do have the hardware. I would just like to find an esports coach that would like to run it as an official team. That's the struggle for me at this point. But we are working with Mr. Mahar, and if any kids are interested in doing some esports, I would encourage you to go to attend a chess club meeting, because we are going to sprinkle in some esports into that club.
There you have it, folks. So as you see, if you need any esports club, please come to this man right here.
CD 102,
right?
You are correct.
Okay, nice.
What's good, MHS? It's Elijah Ace here, bringing you a new section called interactions with students and ask random students, hey, what's your favorite video game as a kid and how badly could I beat you in it? Let's get into it. Kicking it off with
Mishan.
What was your favorite video game growing up as a kid and why?
Budokai Tenkaichi 3 on the PlayStation 2. Why? Because when I was younger, I used to watch a lot of Dragon Ball as a kid. So, you know, it's been a, you know, been a long journey. So, yeah.
All right. Now, on a scale from 1 to 10, how badly would I clap you in Dragon Ball Budokai?
Zero.
The question again. On a scale from 1 to 10, how badly would I destroy you?
Zero.
With one in front of it.
Zero.
We're here with
Christian Oliver.
All right, Chris, so as a kid, what was your favorite game growing up and why?
My favorite game growing up as a kid was Super Mario, especially on the Wii. Super Mario Bros. Wii. I have so much fun memories playing with my little brothers and them. We just talked a lot. We started crying, raging over the game. Especially when my dad showed me a glitch on the game that gives you 99 life. It was fun. It was just perfect. I miss playing that game with my brothers and my dad.
Now, on a scale from 1 to 10, how badly would I beat you in a speed run?
In a speed run, probably a 7 out of 10. It's based on the game that you play, that you want to beat me in. It was Call of Duty. I'll definitely beat you in a speed run in that game. If it was Super Mario, you probably would. Depends if I got to memorize where the pipes are at, where the stars are at, all the coins, good stuff. Basically, I have to memorize a lot if you want me to beat me, or I got to beat you in a speed run.
We're kicking it off with Carl. Yes, sir. All right, Carl, what was your favorite video game as a kid growing up?
Raging Blast 2.
All right, okay. Valid. Now, on a scale from 1 to 10, how badly would I destroy you in that game?
Nah, zero.
With a 1 in front of it, right?
Zero.
He in denial. Kicking it off with
Sasha.
So what was your favorite game as a kid growing up?
Actually, I have two. It's Street Fighter and Mortal Kombat.
All right, on a scale from 1 to 10, how badly would I clap you in both of those games?
I'm going to be dead honest. Probably a 1.
With a 0 in front of it.
Yeah, I guess.
Yeah.
0.1, so not quite.
No.
10. Nah.
All right, and out of both of those games, what's your favorite character?
It has to be Katana, and it has to be Ryu.
Kicking it off with?
Carmelo.
All right, so first off, what was your favorite video game growing up as a kid?
Probably Modern Warfare, for sure.
Okay, Modern Warfare, valid. All right, so on a scale from 1 to 10, how badly would I clap you in Modern Warfare?
All right,
gentlemen. Wait.
With the mystery unfolding, we are excited to see the return of esports back in action. Signing off for PNN, I'm Michael LeGrand. We'll see you next time on Kickoff.
The marching band Band Pirates are very busy currently doing games, competition, and much more. To put on their best performance, all of the Band of Pirates practice many hours to show their amazing skills. The students explain how being in the band is and how they practice their sets.
I rate being in the band an 8 out of 10 because marching band is really fun, but the only thing that keeps it from being a perfect 10 is that we still have to do regular schoolwork, so it's exhausting, but it's still really fun. This year we practiced our sets by Mr. Danielson and Ms. Winkle giving us a number, and we remember that number, and we continuously practice our sets every Tuesday and Thursday.
So I played the baritone. I'm also a little section leader, but I enjoy playing the baritone because, you know, nobody usually plays it, and now that I play it, it adds on to the band, you know?
Mr. Danielson explains how hard is it to learn the sets and how they learn it.
Well, every year we practice our sets by giving students what are called dots. Those are places on the field to start from, and we also give them the next dot. That's the next space they're supposed to occupy. Previously, what we used to do that is use what's called a carpenter's crayon, like a thick, fat wax crayon, and we would mark our spots that way. This year, we chose not to do any dots like that, just a place on the field so they can guide off of or follow or be in line with, that's what guiding is, to the person next to them or the person in front of them or behind them. So we find that this year it's easier to do.
As you can see, the members of the Marching Band work really hard to be the best they can be. With continued practice, we know they will be very successful at the competition and other events.
Turning off opinion, I'm Amia.
With the homecoming dance coming up, there are many events that come along with it, such as the homecoming game and the homecoming parade. For the homecoming parade, many clubs are working hard on their floats. This year's theme for floats is decade, and clubs got to choose what decade they want and then decorate their float and dress up to represent their chosen decade.
The art club decided that we were going to do cartoons through the decades. So we're drawing cartoon characters for each of the decades, and then we're going to display them. So we're going to walk through the parade with the characters on the, like a sandwich, like a, you know, how they have the boards on the front and the back. So that's our plan. They're going to walk the art, so that way we can get closer to the crowd, and they can see it. And this way, some of the parents will go, oh yeah, I remember that one. And some of the young ones will be going, oh yeah, there it is.
We're drawing characters from old shows to kind of remind kids, like, oh, I remember that show from when I was little and all that stuff, right? But also it goes with the decades. I chose two characters from Trolls. One of them I already drew, Poppy, and now I'm currently drawing Branch.
The art club has taken a different approach to the homecoming parade by simply wearing their art instead of being on a homecoming float. Another club that has been working just as hard is the GSA.
So for the GSA, we chose the 60s. Originally, our plan was to go through and do something related to Stonewall, because that's really important to the LGBT community. But when we went through all of our votes and everything, we ended up landing on the 60s, and then we were going to kind of do a little bit of a focus on Scooby-Doo, since that came out in the 60s. Instead, what we're doing is we have some like decorations that we're going to put on, still make it look like the Mystery Machine, and then we have a big rainbow arch that's going to go on top, and then everybody who's following will have something that they're holding as well.
As we see, all the clubs are hard at work with their floats and costumes. We hope to see students and teachers go to the parade to support different clubs at Maryville High School.
The Jericho Appreciation Society. For over 5 weeks, the recognized symbol of excellence of sports entertainers.
You are innocence personified, and AEW, a wrestling company established back in 2019. New competition to the rival wrestling promotion, WWE, which has been around for 69 years. AEW founded by Cody Rhodes, Kenny Omega, The Young Bucks, and Tony Khan, the owner of AEW, and son of Jacksonville Jaguars owner Shad Khan, has been gaining popularity over the last 3 years, making wrestling fans split. Wrestling superstars have been unhappy with WWE for some time now. When AEW made ground, those superstars found a place that they thought could fulfill all of what they wanted. For example, AEW signed wrestling legends like Sting, Chris Jericho, long anticipated CM Punk. They also signed other superstars that hoped to be the top guy, but couldn't in WWE. Superstars like Jon Moxley, Adam Cole, Miro, Malakai Black, and many more. AEW has also built up talent themselves. Talent like MJF, Darby Allin, Jungle Boy, and the Dr. Britt Baker. AEW has grown so much, and we want to hear people's opinion on AEW.
My opinion on AEW as a whole is that I think it's really entertaining. I know that it's not for everybody, but I think it does give some options, which currently is really important. I think WWE kind of was the only stop in town for a long time, so to have something else to watch for wrestling fans has been a nice alternative.
As a whole, I like AEW. I think it's a good alternative to WWE. Ask your history teachers. Monopolies are never good for anything. WWE had a monopoly on pro wrestling market, and I think having an alternative has made things better for everybody.
In AEW, the superstars do crazy moves, but there is still more improvement to make it more popular.
I'm not sure AEW wants to get more popular, more mainstream. I think they're kind of good with WWE being the mainstream market, and they're kind of the indie band that hasn't cracked the mainstream just yet, and they like their core hardcore wrestling fan base. But if they wanted to get more mainstream, getting some sort of deal where they have streaming service as opposed to people buying their pay-per-views might be a way to get more attention mainstream.
I think that to get more popular, AEW could work on some long-term storytelling. I know that that's not necessarily what their strength is, and some of the storylines that they have focused on in terms of long-term have kind of worked out to be some of the most popular, but on the whole, I think it'd be more entertaining if they could carry it better week to week.
But AEW wouldn't be where it is today without the fans cheering on their favorite superstars.
My favorite guys in AEW, MJF is pretty great. Samoa Joe, brought him back. He's a great on the microphone. Miro is pretty good. And everybody loves the Acclaimed, right?
Don't be mad at me, bro, because you only know for your wife's reality show. And you should eat some eggs. Look at Bowen's arms, they're bigger than your legs. I'm going to put you into poverty, dog, because I end careers quicker than your father-in-law.
My favorite superstar currently, probably MJF. I think that he's just the most entertaining. Typically when he's on screen, something worth watching is going to happen. And I think kind of the craziest part is he doesn't really even wrestle that much. He just mostly has the microphone.
Outsider, because you might as well be coming out here preaching hustle, loyalty, and respect. Who can blame you, Punky? I mean, your whole entire career on the stick, you've been big fish, small pond, and standing across from me, you're just a freaking minnow. You didn't want to go toe-to-toe with me on the stick, Punk? Well, too bad, because I'm about to verbally finish you quicker than your UFC career.
Some of these superstars didn't just start in big-name companies. They had to make a name for themselves in the independent wrestling promotions, and there are a lot of big talent in the indies.
I think AEW needs to maybe pause signing a talent. They got almost too much talent right now, not enough space for everybody. But if they were going to sign some, there's this guy Cheeseburger. He's pretty good out on the indies. Russ Jones is a guy I've heard about on the indies. That's pretty good. I don't know if they've officially signed a Bandito yet, but he's pretty good. I wouldn't get anybody from WWE, though. They've done too much of that at this point. So I think they should pause on the signing from WWE.
I don't think that they should sign anybody else. I think that they have a huge pool of talent, and to only occupy two shows, I think their focus should be to kind of refine the talent that they have and make sure that people are all kind of put in the right place and that they're using the characters in a way that makes the most sense.
Better than you, and you know it.
AEW is still pretty new and is still trying to get better year after year. Whether it's the superstars or the stunts they do, AEW is still a pretty entertaining show that people should start watching. Signing off from PNN, I'm Jalen Ferguson.
Last Thursday, in a special Thursday night game, the Washington Commanders defeated the Chicago Bears by a final score of 12-7, with another chance to win the game. In the final moments, the Bears couldn't come up with the victory and now sit with an overall record of 2-4. Let's see how it all went down. To begin the game, in the first, quarterback Justin Fields uses his legs to pick up some big yards and get the night started. The Bears find themselves in a big hole at 3rd-and-19, and Fields takes a sack from a host of Commanders, and the Bears are forced to punt it away. Late in the first, the Bears find themselves in the red zone, where Fields' pass gets knocked up and intercepted by Washington. On to the second quarter, and Herbert breaks off a big run and gets the Bears in scoring position. Unfortunately, Fields can't quite make it into the end zone, and the Bears are again stopped short on 4th-and-goal.
Under center, 4th-and-goal. Herbert, can he get in? No signal yet. Washington thinks they have stopped him. And for the moment, it appears they have.
With under a minute to go in the first half, the Commanders get on the board first with a field goal and take a 3-0 lead. Third quarter action now, and the Bears' quick tempo offense leads to a big Dante Pettis touchdown that even Amazon missed. Into the fourth quarter with a 7-6 score, and a major mistake cost the Bears dearly as they muff a Washington punt and set up the Commanders in the red zone. A few plays later, Washington would take the lead with a big touchdown, but would fail to build upon that after a missed field goal late in the game. With one final chance, Justin Fields would march the Bears downfield, leading to a red zone opportunity to win the game. Sadly, on 4th-and-goal with the game on the line, Fields' pass to Mooney falls just inches short of the line, and Commanders would seal the victory.
Fake toss to the end zone, and it is juggled. Did he catch it? No, he did not. Incomplete. Mooney, for the moment, looked like he might have it. Does not. He got St. Juice covering on the play. Mooney goes up. Ooh, boy. When does he have control of it?
Yeah, the ball goes up right in the air. If he would have had it.
It's bobbled, and by the time he gets control, he's back outside the goal line. St. Juice covering on the play. So if he holds on to it there, he's across the goal line. He's in. But he doesn't. He gets control outside of the goal line. You can't be any closer than that.
Another week and another disappointing loss. The Bears now sit at 2-4 and fall further behind in the division race. With a few extra days off, the Bears now head to New England to battle the Patriots on Monday Night Football next week. Hopefully our beloved Bears can get back in the win column. With your Bears report, this is Omarion Thomas signing off.
Every fall, Maryville High School puts on the annual fall play. The audience gets to see the glamorous final product on stage. But something we don't see is what takes place behind the scenes to put on the amazing show.
I'm Mr. Mackey. I am the director of the fall play and sponsor of Thespian Troop 1692. This year for the fall play, we are doing an adaptation of George Orwell's classic novel 1984. The story, the boring version is that it's a novel about government overreach, but you're not interested in that. What you want to know is that it's about a guy who is fighting for his freedom against a government that wants him only to be an obedient servant, and that government controls every aspect of his life, and he's looking for a way to try to destroy it from within.
Theater is not only a place for students to express themselves artistically, but also a place where students create lasting memories.
My name is Carlton Clay, and I play O'Brien in 1980. So that was great. I got to meet a lot of new people and began to bond. I'm currently in a group of three of us, and we are the Plastics. So yeah, yeah.
My name is Genesis Williams. My character, I play Loudspeaker. So yeah. Honestly, for the past school plays that I've been in, for the past few ones, I think my favorite part behind the scenes was like how well the cast knows each other and how close we all are. It's really easy to work with them, and there's like literally like little to no conflict. So I think that's like one of my favorite parts.
Hi, my name is Precious Moore, and I'm Julia in the upcoming play 1984, and I've been doing theater for 3 years. My favorite behind the scenes would be from Charlie Brown when Lucy punched Linus. It was just really funny, and all the times we'll be behind the stage laughing like really loudly.
There are many important tools that it takes to put together a fall play.
In order to put together a really solid production, you really need to have a great team. Even though my name is listed as director, I do very little compared to the dozens of students who are working on this show. It's not just about the actors. It's about the students that we have designing the play, from the scenery to the costumes, the sound, the lighting. We have the students that are building the sets and painting the sets and putting the costumes together. We have stage managers that are keeping everything organized and keeping everybody on task. We have stage crew members that will be shifting the scenery on and off stage and assisting with various things in the backstage area. So there are so many people that are involved with this production, and absolutely every single one of them is a vital part of our show. And if we don't have good team members that are looking to help do what it is that we do and to help make a great production, then our production will fall apart regardless of, you know, who's at the helm.
As we have seen, there are so many important things when it comes to putting together an amazing fall play. From the ushers to the actors, they all play such important roles. Theater is an atmosphere of creativity and expression. MHS theater program has opened up so many doors for past and current students, whether that be through scholarships or finding a sense of family or even just a space where they feel welcome. The upcoming play, 1984, debuts November 3rd in Reinhardt Auditorium. Please come support your MHS theater program. Your support and donations helps us continue to create these amazing pieces of theater, build a community where students are able to express themselves and their creativity.
Signing off for PNN, I'm Madison Jobert.